We'll go on and start.
I'd like to call the hearing to order this morning. And this is our first hearing in the second session of the 114th Congress. And I want to take this opportunity to wish everybody and the committee and those in attendance a very happy and productive 2016. This subcommittee has continuously examined legislation aimed at reducing red tape when it is standing in the way of economic development and development of energy infrastructure that would benefit this country. Projects that update and expand the nation's energy infrastructure will create jobs and lead to greater supplies of affordable domestic energy for our homes and businesses. And affordable energy is very important because we're in a competitive world today. We're competing with other countries, and the price of electricity and energy goes a long way in determining where businesses locate and jobs are created. So this is the unifying theme behind the eight bills that we're going to be discussing today. H.R. 3021 is the Air Survey Act of 2015, which was introduced by Mr. Pompeo, is an overdue measure to incorporate data collected through aerial surveys into the approval process for natural gas infrastructure. H.R. 2984, the Fair Rates Act, which was introduced by Mr. Kennedy, sets out a process to deal with those situations under the Federal Power Act in which FERC neither approves nor denies an electricity rate change, such as when the commission is deadlocked. A draft bill entitled A Bill to Amend Section 203 of the Federal Power Act would serve to address an oversight in the Energy Policy Act of 2005. That law amended Section 203 of the Federal Power Act, which pertains to the sale, disposition, merger, purchase, and acquisition of certain utility assets and facilities. Along with these three bills making procedural changes, we also have before us five bills dealing with new hydroelectric projects on existing dams. Given the low cost and low emissions of hydropower, these projects ought to be among the least controversial issues of increasing the nation's electricity supply. However, the FERC-issued license for these projects have expired, or soon will expire, largely because of regulatory delays or unforeseen circumstances that have prevented construction. These bills extend the life of the license by 6 to 8 years, allowing these job-creating projects to move forward. The result of the passage of these eight bills will be more jobs, more energy for the American people at an affordable price, and I would urge all my colleagues to support them. So that concludes my opening statement. This time I'd like to introduce and recognize the gentleman from Chicago, Mr. Rush, and also wish you a happy new year, Mr. Rush. And he's recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I wish you a happy new year, and I wish all those who are in this committee room a happy new year also. And I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding today's hearing on these eight energy infrastructure bills. Mr. Chairman, while I support the majority of these bills before us today, I do have some concerns that I would look forward to addressing as we move forward through the legislative process. In regards to the five bills extending the time period for expired hydropower licenses, I support each of these pieces of legislation. These bills would extend the construction time for hydropower projects across the country up to 8 years, and I commend my colleagues for sponsoring these important bills. Hydropower is a renewable source of energy that has received widespread bipartisan support from members of this subcommittee, and allowing these projects to commence will help increase the nation's portfolio of clean, homegrown energy resources. Mr. Chairman, I also support very strongly my colleague Mr. Kennedy's bill, the Fair Rates Act, which would provide the public with an opportunity to legally challenge rate changes approved by FERC, essentially by default. Mr. Chairman, five times in the past 14 years, rate changes have been approved by default due to the commission being deadlocked during a vote. Even when these rate changes negatively impact consumers, the public currently has no legal recourse to challenge these cases, as a deadlocked vote is not legally viewed as in order. The Fair Rates Act would rectify this inequity by treating new rate changes, including those that go into effect by default, as a FERC order that could be challenged administratively and through the courts by consumers. Protecting consumers and average Americans should be a primary objective of all the bills this committee considers. And while I support most of these legislation that we're considering today, I'm not sure that the remaining two bills meet that same high threshold. Mr. Chairman, I look forward to engaging today's witnesses on both H.R. 3021, the Air Survey Act of 2016, and the bill that will amend Section 203 of the Federal Power Act. For both of these pieces of legislation, I want to make sure that there aren't any unintended consequences that we are overlooking before we move forward in making these important policy changes. My biggest concern is with H.R. 3021, which will require FERC to give the same equal weight to aerial survey data that it does for ground survey data in the pre-filing process, and for the completion of an application for construction of a natural gas pipeline. Mr. Chairman, I look forward to hearing from our expert panelists on the practical impact of this change in policy for both landowners as well as the impact on the environment. So once again, Mr. Chairman, I applaud you for holding this timely hearing today, and I look forward to hearing from all of our expert witnesses. And with that, I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Rush. At this time, I'd like to recognize a gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Pallone, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and our ranking member for this hearing today on a number of bills addressing programs and projects administered by FERC. I'm particularly pleased that the subcommittee is considering H.R. 2984, Representative Kennedy's Fair Rates Act, which would greatly improve the process by which FERC votes are reconsidered. This small but insignificant but significant change to the Federal Power Act would ensure that if there is a deadlocked vote amongst commissioners, there will still be recourse for eligible parties to seek a review of the rates that result from a de facto decision of the commission. The need for this change became evident in the wake of a New England forward capacity market auction in 2014. At that time, FERC had only four commissioners, and they split over the question of whether the auction results were just and reasonable. Since FERC didn't disapprove the auction results, wholesale electricity prices in New England increased dramatically. So while rates went up, none of the affected parties could challenge the decision or resulting rate increase, and therefore no rehearing or judicial review was possible. There's an old saying, Mr. Chairman, that if you choose not to decide, you still have made a choice, and we should not deprive stakeholders of any recourse when a non-decision by FERC has real consequences for consumers, producers, and others. Representative Kennedy's bill doesn't favor one side or another. It merely provides those who want to challenge the outcome of inaction the same rights they would have if FERC made an affirmative decision. It's thoughtful and meaningful legislation that deserves to become law as soon as possible. Unfortunately, I can't say the same about the Air Survey Act of 2015. It's a reckless and brazen effort to further strip landowners and resource agencies of their ability to participate meaningfully in the gas pipeline siting process. The bill directs FERC and agencies responsible for implementing federal environmental laws not just to allow data collected by air to be used in gas pipeline certification activities, but it goes so far as to tell scientists and regulators to give it the same weight in the decision process as data collected on the ground. We should not categorically make a decision that photos taken thousands of feet in the air are as accurate in cataloging endangered plants and animals as surveys on the ground. Nor should we second-guess scientists and other trained professionals in state environmental offices or at the Army Corps as to how best to collect data related to their implementation of the Clean Water Act. Furthermore, this legislation is not needed. FERC already allows aerial data to be used in proceedings under Section 7 of the Natural Gas Act. The only reason to move the legislation is to short-circuit meaningful environmental assessments and to get around the concerns of private landowners and, in some cases, local governments who have legitimately barred pipeline companies from surveying after those companies were caught acting illegally without proper authorization. It's a bad concept and a bad bill, and it should not move any further. Mr. Pompeo's other legislative proposal is, on the other hand, something worth exploring. The committee print before us would add a $10 million threshold to trigger FERC review of a merger or consolidation, since under current law no such threshold exists. I'm particularly interested in hearing from Mr. Slocum regarding the concerns he raised with this legislation, because this is not a change that we should undertake lightly. I look forward to working with my colleagues to see if there is a way forward on this issue. And finally, I just want to say that I know of no major objection with regard to any of the five hydroelectric construction license extension bills before us. They have all bipartisan support, and I hope we'll move quickly on them. I appreciate the chair and the ranking member for holding this hearing and the witnesses. And I'd like to yield the remainder of my time to Mr. Kennedy.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pallone. I'm grateful, and I want to thank the chairman and the ranking member for holding the important hearing. My constituents face the highest energy rates in the continental United States, so today's discussion about skyrocketing energy costs is unfortunately nothing new to my home state. But what happened to us 2 years ago, after rates were filed with FERC, should never happen, no matter how expensive or cheap your energy bill is. The commission, which at that time was down to four commissioners, deadlocked. The rates became effective by operation of law, precluding any avenue for administrative redress. As a result, any and all protests of those rates were dismissed because, according to FERC and the Federal Power Act, there was no decision to rehear. That is unacceptable, but there's nothing my constituents could do to protest because of the flaw in the Federal Power Act. My bill, H.R. 2984, the Fair Rates Act, is a simple technical fix to ensure that scenario doesn't happen again. It ensures all administrative and judicial avenues for redress are available whenever new rates take effect, including in the advent of a deadlocked commission. And today, FERC once again is down only to four commissioners, without a fifth so much as nominated, setting the stage for that event to play out again in the next weeks or in the month ahead. I appreciate FERC's thoughts on the legislation and their work with both me and my staff over the past several years. I look forward to hearing from the witnesses, and particularly Bill Battigi, who was willing to come down to Washington to share his expertise with us. I yield back. Thank you.
The gentleman yields back, and that concludes our opening statements today. So we have two panels of witnesses, and on our first panel, we have two witnesses. I'd like to welcome them. First, Ann Miles, who is the director of the Office of Energy Projects at the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and the other witness is Max Menzner, who's General Counsel, Office of the General Counsel, Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. I thank both of you very much for taking time to be with us today to give your thoughts and ideas about these pieces of legislation. And Ms. Miles, I'll recognize you first for 5 minutes for your opening statement.
Thank you.
And be sure to turn the microphone on.
Good morning, Chairman Whitfield, Ranking Member Rush, and members of the subcommittee. My name is Ann Miles, and I'm the Director of the Office of Energy Projects at the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. The Commission is responsible for siting infrastructure, including non-federal hydropower projects, interstate natural gas pipelines and storage facilities, and liquefied natural gas terminals. I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you to comment on the five hydropower bills to extend commencement of construction deadlines and on the Aerial Infrastructure Route Survey Act of 2015. As a member of the Commission's staff, the views I express in this testimony are my own and not those of the chairman, other than as specifically noted, or of any individual commissioner. I will first comment on the hydropower extension bills, H.R. 2080, H.R. 2081, H.R. 3447, the bill regarding Jennings-Randolph Project Number 12715, and the bill regarding Cannonsville Project Number 13287. Each of the bills seeks to extend the project's commencement of construction deadline to a total of no more than 10 years from the date the project license was issued. The last several commission chairmen, as well as the current chairman, have taken the position of not opposing legislation that would extend the commencement of construction deadline no further than 10 years from the date the license in question was issued. Because each of these bills provides for commencement of construction deadlines that do not exceed 10 years from the dates of the respective licenses being issued, I do not oppose these bills. I note that all bills, except for H.R. 2081, contain a reinstatement provision should the period required for commencement of construction expire prior to enactment of the Act. Congress may want to consider including a reinstatement provision in H.R. 2081. Second, I will comment on the Aerial Infrastructure Route Survey Act, H.R. 3021. The bill would amend Section 7 of the Natural Gas Act to provide that data collected by aerial survey will be accepted in lieu of and given equal weight to ground survey data for the purpose of completing the Commission's natural gas project pre-filing process and for completing applications associated with federal authorizations related to such projects. The bill provides that an agency may require that aerial survey data be verified through the use of on-the-ground survey data before project construction. Aerial surveys can be a useful tool for developing project routes and making initial determinations of resources that may be affected by a proposed project. Currently, Commission staff accepts aerial survey data, especially where ground access is not available during the pre-filing or application review process. However, most projects' applications include ground survey data for a significant portion of the right-of-way. I do have some concern that waiting to verify large amounts of aerial data until late in the project development process or after issuance of a certificate could, in some cases, pose difficulties. For example, if it was not discovered until the pre-construction stage that a project might affect historic properties or endangered species, matters that can be difficult to determine with certainty in the absence of on-the-ground surveys. A project proponent might be required at a late stage to amend its approved route or to conduct additional mitigation, which could cause delay and additional expense. This concludes my remarks, and I would be pleased to answer any questions you may have.
Ms. Miles, thanks very much for your opening statement. And Mr. Menzer, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Rush, members of the subcommittee, thank you for inviting me to testify here today. My name is Max Minsner. I'm the General Counsel at the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. Like Ms. Wiles, I'm also a staff witness, and my remarks today don't necessarily reflect the views of the chairman or any specific commissioner. I've been asked to testify today on two bills that would amend the Federal Power Act. One is a bill that would modify Section 203 of the Federal Power Act to set a minimum threshold value of $10 million on the merger or consolidation of facilities belonging to public utilities that would be required for FERC approval.
And two, H.R. 2984, a bill that would amend Section 205 of the Federal Power Act that would permit a party to seek rehearing and subsequent appellate review of any rate change filed under Section 205 that takes effect without commission action. The first proposed bill would amend a provision of the Federal Power Act, Section 203, that requires public utilities to seek commission approval before engaging in a wide range of corporate transactions. In particular, this bill would change the act so that utilities would only need prior FERC approval to merge or consolidate facilities subject to the commission's jurisdiction if the facility's value is in excess of $10 million. In other words, mergers or consolidations of facilities with a value less than that amount would not need FERC approval. This bill would align this provision of the FPA with the other subsections of Section 203A1, which regulate other transactions by public utilities, each of which already contains a $10 million de minimis threshold. In my view, the proposal to add the same de minimis threshold to Section 203A1B of the FPA could ease the administrative burden on commission staff and the regulatory burden on industry without a significant negative effect on the commission's regulatory responsibilities. Transactions below that threshold are unlikely to impose a significant negative impact on competition or the rates of utility customers. Second, H.R. 2984 would permit rehearing and appellate review of changes to rates made under Section 205 when those rates take effect without commission action. To change rates or other tariff provisions under Section 205, a public utility typically makes a filing with FERC, and the commission will take action on the proposal during a 60-day statutory time period. In very rare cases, the commission has not acted on that filing within the time period, and the filing takes effect when the period expires. In my view, rehearing and appellate review are not currently available when a filing submitted pursuant to Section 205 of the FPA takes effect by operation of law. Appellate review is an important procedural avenue, though, for those who do not prevail before an administrative agency. While review in the Court of Appeals may be challenging under this legislation, because the appellate court will not be able to rely on the Commission's reasoning in the first instance, the possibility of a rehearing order or a remand from the Court of Appeals should reduce this difficulty and allow the Court of Appeals to effectively engage in review of the rate change. That concludes my prepared testimony. I look forward to your questions.
Mr. Minister, thank you, and thank both of you for those your testimony. At this time, I recognize myself for 5 minutes of questions, and I yield my time to the gentleman from Kansas, Mr. Pompeo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for yielding to me as well. Ms. Miles, thank you for being here this morning. I want to ask you a couple questions about H.R. 3021. Can you describe for me some of the benefits of having access to aerial route survey data for FERC?
Well, aerial survey can be very useful in making general determinations or in some resource areas more specific determinations. So certainly for site getting the route and initial determinations, yes, it can be useful.
I appreciate that. Yeah, I want to talk about a couple of the concerns that you expressed and trying to understand them so that we might be able to make some changes that accommodate them if we need to. In regard to endangered species, considering all the time and money spent protecting them, isn't it safe to assume that we know where those habitats are?
Not necessarily on a specific project. The details would be required for us as well as other federal agencies whose responsibility are for dealing with the species, the Fish and Wildlife Service, especially for pipeline projects.
But isn't it the case that the company that's intending to do this survey is going to do their best to identify that? That is, they don't want to have big amendments at the end either. They have an enormous financial incentive to get this right.
Very understandable that, and as we are seeing, and as I said in our projects so far, most companies, where they can have project access early, are gathering that data.
Now that makes,
all want to do as much as they can during pre-filing.
Yeah, no, that makes perfect sense. And when you have ground access, that's great. But in those instances where I think this is most important is the places where ground access is not available, it's been denied. And so the only other option would be being very disruptive to the landowner, either eminent domain or something of that nature, and this is a way to mitigate the impact to those landowners and still get the information that we all need to make sure that that certificate is properly granted. And it seems to me we've struck the right balance here. Do you agree with that?
I think on a narrower course of that, it would be. I'm not sure the bill is specific about the areas where there isn't access, isn't on the ground access.
Makes sense. And the same thing with respect to historic sites. Those are listed, so we don't, right, most often we don't have to guess. I suppose there's a handful that are unknown, but that has to be the rarest of creatures.
I'm sorry, I missed what
With respect to historic sites, you expressed some concern that an aerial survey might not adequately identify a historic site. There's a registry of historic sites, right? And that's not hard to figure out where they are.
I think that many of those, though, will require require on-the-ground work. Yes, there is a register of historic sites, but sometimes there are sites along the way that haven't been identified. We know there are archaeological or cultural sites, but they haven't been identified and they're not on the register yet. And so it could take on-the-ground survey to get at that information.
Yeah, I just think about these companies that are trying to do this. They're gonna try and get that right. They have the most vested interest in making sure that they do that right. And if they need a ground survey to do it, I'm confident they'll work through it. I just think it's important that they and FERC have access to this tool so that we can be less disruptive to landowners as we're working our way through the process. Thanks for your testimony. Mr. Minister, a question for you on the amendment to the draft. Tell me to Section 203, tell me what the scale of the burden that this would relieve on FERC is. And can you give me a man hours if we adjust these limits to the place that's proposed? Tell me what benefits accrue to FERC in terms of reduced burden.
Congressman, thank you for that question.
Mr. Minister, be sure and pull your microphone closer. Interestingly enough, we have people watching this on the internet, and they complained that they didn't hear everything you said. So.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for your question, Congressman. I don't think I have an estimate of the number of man hours that it would save the commission. I do know that about 20% of the Section 203 applications that FERC considered in fiscal year 2015 would fall below the statutory threshold and therefore would not have needed approval if this bill were in place last year. I can tell you that every filing that comes into the commission under Section 203 otherwise, staff looks at closely, and if commission action is required, a draft order is prepared for the commission. Every filing is taken seriously and staff works on intensively.
Do you see any downside risk from creating parity between acquisitions and dispositions, right? They're very similar. Do you see any burden or any downside to what we're proposing in just making parity as between those two types of transactions?
Well, the value of the bill, of course, would, as you said, bring parity between this provision of Section 203 and otherwise. It is, of course, a policy choice of how much oversight Congress wants these mergers to have at the commission level. In my view, transactions that are below the de minimis threshold pose relatively limited risk to rates or competition.
Great. Thank you very much. And thank you again for yielding, Mr. Chairman.
This time, I recognize the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Rush, for 5 minutes.
I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Miles, in your statement, you note that currently most project applications include ground surveys for a significant portion of the right-of-way. You also state that waiting to verify large amounts of aerial data until late in the project development process or after issuance of a certificate could in some cases pose difficulties. Are you concerned that the policy change outlined in the Air Survey Act of 2016 may in fact actually lead to delays and additional costs for pipeline projects rather than expediting these same projects? And can you explain your concerns?
I think if it is carried out similarly to now, where the companies are doing the on-the-ground surveys where they have access, then and in the majority of the cases, companies do have access to a good bit of the survey route and are able to do the on-the-ground surveys in the earlier stages of the certification process. As long as that continues, I think that's fine. As I said in my testimony, aerial survey data can be useful where there is not on-the-ground access. As long as there is the opportunity to verify that later in the process by actual on-the-ground surveys for the resource areas where it would be necessary. It's not necessary for all resource areas.
Thank you. Mr. Minzer, in your statement, you cited serial mergers as a possible concern with the bill to amend Section 203 of the Federal Power Act. You state that the commission would no longer have the authority to review and approve mergers valued at less than $10 million, even in situations where the merger took place as one of a series of transactions that exceeded the limit in total. However, you also state that you believe that FERC has other tools available to protect consumers and the public interest if circumstances such as what I described would arise. Can you explain what are these other tools that the FERC has at its disposal that would help in the situation that I described?
Yes, Congressman, thank you. The Commission has a range of regulatory tools that it exercises in its oversight of public utilities regulated under the Federal Power Act. For instance, if a utility gains market power and is in a situation where it has authority to charge market-based rates, the Commission can modify or eliminate that authority to charge market-based rates. To the extent that a public utility is operating in one of the Commission-approved organized wholesale electric markets, there are a range of Commission-approved mitigation measures that are designed to limit or eliminate the exercise of market power. And of course, the Commission retains its enforcement authority to regulate misconduct that's a violation of a Commission rule or order or rises to the level of market manipulation. Those are three of examples of mechanisms the Commission would have to regulate the exercise of market power or other misconduct, even in the absence of the merger authority.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. This time, recognize the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Olson, for 5 minutes.
I thank the chair, and welcome to our friends from FERC. I'm going to talk about natural gas and pipelines. The questions will be mostly for Ms. Miles, but Mr. Mansour, if the spirit so moves you, please answer when you feel comfortable. There's been a big change in the last decade. Our electric grid relies heavily on natural gas. If the President's Clean Power Plan survives in court, that trend will continue and accelerate. Gas is critical as a baseload power. It's immune to weather, and it's critical for ramping up and down to let wind and solar on our grids. Gas can't keep the lights on without a robust pipeline system. And that's why this committee examines legislation designed to make the permitting process more reasonable. My first question is for you, Ms. Miles. It's a broad one on the pipeline landscape. And I'll dive into a few specifics about siting. First, what trends do you see in pipeline construction, and what does this tell you about the future of natural gas?
We've seen a tremendous increase in the workload before us, both for natural gas pipelines as well as for liquefied natural gas facilities, at least doubling in the number of projects that are before us, in some cases tripling in the capacity that would move through those pipelines, and similar increases in interest in liquefied natural gas projects.
Mr. Minzer, care to comment, sir?
Nothing to add to Ms. Miles.
That's okay, that's fine. Again, Ms. Miles, as FERC's lead agency for siting natural gas pipelines that cross across state lines, Y'all are responsible for setting the schedule and coordinating all the various environmental permits. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Would you prefer to review those various permits, like Clean Water Act permits, and all the other boxes that need to be checked, done concurrently on the order they are submitted as opposed to successfully? Do you prefer that, concurrently as opposed to successfully?
The more that we can work at the same time in gathering information and reviewing that information, working together on our environmental documents, yes, that is a good thing.
Concurrent good versus successive. Okay, great. Are you aware of any situations where a state agency acting pursuant to a federally delegated authority has failed to meet the schedule established by FERC? Anytime it's happened, a state agency not met your schedules? Are you aware of that?
I'm sorry, I'm not prepared to answer that today, but I'd be happy to get back to you on.
Thank you. Mr. Menzies, you want to swing at that one, sir?
I also don't know the answer to that question, but I would second Ms. Miles' comment to the extent that we can work collaboratively with other agencies. That's an important and valuable thing for us to do.
Final question about LNG. I've heard that FERC has slipped past its own deadlines recently on some LNG export terminals. As we all know, the first export of LNG is scheduled to happen later this month, maybe early March, at Sabine Pass in Louisiana, right next to Texas, my home state. With a weak commander-in-chief, the best tool we have to hurt OPEC, Iran, ISIS, and Russia is taking their money from our energy, getting on the global market, selling our natural gas to our allies. What is FERC doing to address the LNG exports in a timely manner? Make sure we get that energy on the market now. Again, hurt OPEC, hurt Russia, hurt ISIS, and hurt Iran.
As with all the projects before us, both LNG and pipeline projects, we work to expedite them as best we can. We are in, well, for LNG projects, they are required to use our pre-filing process. We think that's a very good opportunity for all the agencies, tribes, as well as the company to look at what issues and what information is needed, so that when the application is filed, it is a complete application and we are able to go as quickly as we can to our environmental analysis of the project.
Yeah, please, please expedite, because no project right across river from Sabine Pass is having some problems moving forward with the permitting process. So please, please do that, because again, that's the biggest tool we have to battle the guys who like us again, OPEC, ISIS, Iran, and Russia. I yield back. Thank you.
Gentleman yields back. This time, Chair recognizes the gentleman from California, Mr. McNerney, for 5 minutes.
I thank the chairman, and I thank the witnesses this morning. Mrs. Miles, what, if anything, would be missed by relying on aerial surveying in lieu of ground surveys?
I think the issue that we have is we need to make sure that we and the other agencies who have federal permits that need to be carried out have the information they need in order to do that. For some resource areas, as I've said, it may require an on-the-ground survey. So it can be done sequentially with an aerial survey first, as long as the data is collected before the certification, or at least before construction occurs.
Well, in your opinion, can ground surveying be completely eliminated in any conditions?
I do not believe right now that ground surveys in some instances could be eliminated.
Oh, well, in your experience, are there some common causes for delayed, or what are some of the common causes for delays in construction time, start times?
The certificates that are issued will include requirements for the company to get any outstanding permits. Some of those are I don't have a data across the board, but in some projects we are needing to do water quality certification, have that certification from the agencies, or Endangered Species Act consultation completed.
Well, are there any areas in which FERC can help improve the permitting, licensing, and construction processes?
I think what we are trying to do is to work during the pre-filing in pipelines also. It is not a requirement that companies use the pre-filing process, but we do encourage the large pipelines to do so, and they have been doing it routinely. And it is during that pre-filing process that both we and the companies are working with not only us, but the other agencies that are involved. And many, many agencies are cooperating agencies with us in our environmental document, and that's a very valuable thing to do.
I mean, so you're saying that the value is in the pre-application process, that work together cooperatively to find some of the hot spots and fix those beforehand, but what's the difference in terms of ultimate time between the initial application and the licensing? If you take into account the time, the pre-licensing time?
As long as the application that's filed is complete, then we're able to move quite quickly to the environmental document. I'm not quite sure.
I mean, ultimately, if you want to get a permit, how much time do you save by going through a pre-permitting process as opposed to just going into it and wrestling with the FERC during the permitting process?
Our experience is that most projects move more quickly if they have used the pre-filing process. There are some that it's not necessary on, where there aren't a lot of issues, but where there are, it is a valuable thing to use.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Minsner, you mentioned that FERC has tools to protect consumers and public interests if a serial merger is taking place. How often does FERC use those tools, and have they ever been used when reviewing actions under Section 203?
Well, our primary tool when looking at actions under 203 is, in fact, the merger authority. The broad set of tools I referred to involves FERC's overall authority of the rates, terms, and conditions of services of public utilities. One of the goals of the Section 203 and the merger approval is to ensure that a merger does not have an effect on competition or rates. That's one mechanism that FERC carries out its statutory mission to ensure that electric rates are just and reasonable. The other tools are other mechanisms. The Commission is constantly looking at the rates that are filed by electric utilities that operate in Commission markets, has an active program reviewing the market-based rates, and is also continually looking at the mitigation efforts in the organized wholesale markets. So it is something the Commission does routinely as it's looking at the behavior of public utilities.
Can you answer briefly, how many enforcement actions did FERC take in 2015?
I am not aware of the number of enforcement actions Commission's taken in 2015. We'll have to get back to you with that.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
This time, the Chair recognizes the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Shimkus, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just have one issue. It's kind of the last bill noticed, and hopefully I'll be here for the second panel for Mr. Morrison's testimony. But I want to weave the story about legislative language of law, congressional intent, and then obviously agency implementation or lack thereof, which is the thing that we always talk about here, and that our public always harasses us about, because we have the language of law, we have members who are present in the conference committee, we have the record, but then somehow through agency or commission activities, things don't handle as far as we, and then you fall into litigation and lawsuits and all this other stuff. So let me go back to the 2005 energy bill. Again, Mr. Marsan has it, I think, properly identified in his testimony. He's on the second panel. And I was lucky to serve on the conference committee for the passage of that bill, led by, at that time, Chairman Barton. The sole purpose of one of the revisions was to update the pricing of the cost of doing a project from decades ago to a $10 million threshold, where, if it's under that, commission involvement was not needed. We upped that dollar amount to they needed to be based upon $10 million. So I think the original threshold was $50,000 40 years ago. So that was the intent. That's what we did. The law was passed. And now it seems that there is, on the equation line, there is a debate about purchases versus divestitures, and that our argument would be that the intent of the legislation in the 2005 energy bill was to set a new threshold for a dollar amount when the commission should be involved. We don't think you all are doing that, and that is why I think we have the last bill in the series of bills listed for the hearing to address that. We sought to address this issue in HR 8 last year, and we appreciate that we are staying committed, this committee, to making this simple fix once and for all on this piece of standalone legislation. And we're just trying to really, unfortunately, fix something we don't think needs to be fixed based upon commission reading into intent of the language of law that was never meant to be intended by those who served on the conference committee. Do you understand the weaving of the question, and do you have any comments to that?
Yes, Congressman, I'm not aware of any published legislative history on EPAC 2005, but I obviously...
Well, I can tell you what it is. I was there, some of us were there.
You are correct that prior to that legislation, Section 203 contained a $50,000 figure that the Commission had interpreted through its regulations as applying to all the provisions of Section 203. As a result of the change in EPAC 2005, the statute was broken into subsections, three of which contain a $10 million figure, and the one that we're discussing today currently does not. And you're correct, the Commission has interpreted that as not imposing any de minimis threshold for mergers and consolidations. Obviously, this would add that provision into the statute and put us in a situation where the same financial threshold applies to all provisions under Section 203, which was the case prior to EPAC 2005. Then, of course, it was $50,000 rather than $10 million.
Thank you. That's actually a great answer, because I think in answering that, you identified the problem. Three of the provisions were accepted under the $10 million, and the Commission by themselves decided that one did not. We would argue that it was always the congressional intent for $10 million to be that. So I would hope that our colleagues would ask questions as we move this forward and get this fixed in an area that we probably shouldn't have needed to fix. And with that, Mr. Chairman, thank you, and I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. This time, Chair recognizes the gentleman from New York, Mr. Tonko, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ms. Miles and Mr. Minsner, thank you for being here today. Ms. Miles, at what point during the natural gas pipeline application process are data from surveying used?
The data that's gathered would be used in our environmental document.
So
once the application is filed, we would be looking to make sure that we have all the data that we need to analyze the issues that have been raised, and then that would be analyzed in that document and made available to the public to comment on it.
Okay, thank you. And today, is FERC able to accept aerial survey data?
Yes, we are.
And what about the Army Corps of Engineers or any of our state environmental agencies?
I'm not able to speak for them. I understand that they do accept it differently, but I have not experienced that, so I'm not able to speak for them.
Okay, I appreciate that. I understand that FERC is the coordinating agency on these projects, but it seems to me that this bill is really about the data that other agencies, including non-federal agencies, are willing to accept as they work on their studies as part of the application process. think it would be important to hear from those agencies also. Ms. Miles, this bill allows aerial data to be verified by ground surveys after the fact, is that correct?
Yes, after the certification would be issued, then where there's a need to verify the data by ground survey, that would be done then, before construction could begin.
Okay. And do you foresee
the license would spell that out? I mean, the certification would spell out exactly what's needed for which resources.
Okay. And do you foresee the potential for problems or delays if an agency decides that it needs this data to be verified much later in the process?
As I said in my testimony, there are some cases where it has the potential to delay or add additional expense if there is more analysis or perhaps even a rerouting of the pipeline at a later date.
Thank you. And when a natural gas pipeline application is finalized and submitted, about how long will it take, does it take, for FERC to make a decision on any given project?
I'm sorry, could you repeat sure. the question, Congressman?
Sure. When a natural gas pipeline application is finalized and submitted, about how long does it take for FERC to make its decision on a project?
That does vary from project to project, but our record shows that we've issued about 92% of our projects within 1 year from the filing of the application.
So pretty much an average of perhaps less than a year.
Yes.
And since 2005, FERC has authorized a lot of natural gas pipeline infrastructure, over 10,000 miles of interstate transmission pipeline. Am I right in that assumption, in that fact?
I would need to check that fact.
Okay. This bill is a solution, I believe, in search of a problem. FERC is able to process applications currently at an appropriate speed while allowing for public discussion and thorough environmental review. And my fear is that a transition to primarily aerial surveying would alter that dynamic, and it would promote expediency at the expense of property owners' rights. So with that, I think we should be somewhat concerned with these proposed changes and err on the side of property owners and their rights. So I thank you both again for your testimony today. And with that, Mr. Chair, I yield back the balance of my time.
The gentleman yields back. This time, the Chair recognizes the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Latta, for 5 minutes.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for today's hearing, and thank you very much to our witnesses for being with us today. We appreciate your testimony today, and I know some of the questions is kind of like, might sound a little bit redundant, but we're just kind of asking, might not quite asking the same question the same way, but just with a little bit different twist. Ms. Miles, if I could ask you the first few questions. Do you think that the changes in H.R. 3021 work to balance environmental concerns while allowing FERC to more effectively fulfill its mission as the lead agency under Section 7 of the Natural Gas Act?
I think the changes, as I have said, the changes we are accepting aerial survey data at present. However, the companies are tending to do on-the-ground survey when they have access, and that's the key.
So when you're saying you're accepting it right now, so FERC doesn't have any objection right now for allowing aerial surveys for that information to come before you then?
We do not.
Okay. Would FERC object to a state agency using aerial survey data to issue a conditional clean water permit when it's required for a FERC certificate?
I am not able to speak for the other agency.
Okay. And does FERC have any reason to oppose H.R. 3021?
I don't think there's a reason to oppose. I have mentioned what could possibly be a problem if we get a majority of the survey data through aerials late in the process.
Thank you. Mr. Minzner, if I could turn to you. Regarding the Fair Rates Act, in those situations when filings have taken effect under Section 205 without a commission order, how does the commission handle the rehearing requests of those parties that have sought rehearing?
Under the current structure of the Federal Power Act, my view and the stated view of the commission is that rehearing does not lie, so the rehearing petitions are simply dismissed, and that has happened twice. So rehearing is just not acted on.
Let me ask this. So if the commission dismisses these rehearing requests, what recourse do the parties have? Can they appeal the decision of the Court of Appeals?
Our position is under the current version of the Federal Power Act, there is no opportunity for rehearing if the rates take effect as a matter of law, and because rehearing is a prerequisite to appellate review, there's no appellate review either.
Thank you. And you note in your testimony that the Fair Rates Act would have significant benefits. Please expand on these benefits, particularly with respect to the parties seeking rehearing before the Commission and also parties seeking a redress of the Court of Appeals.
Rehearing and appellate review are important ways where individuals and entities that have not succeeded at the administrative stage can seek review of administrative action. It's an important procedural protection, and the primary benefit is that it would allow individuals who disagree with the action of the agency to seek redress in the Court of Appeals.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I'm going to yield back the balance of my time.
Okay, the gentleman yields back. This time, the chair recognizes the gentlelady from California, Ms. Capps, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing and also to today's witnesses for your testimonies. We all agree that we need to ensure a regulatory landscape that successfully addresses energy needs across this nation. Decisions we make regarding our nation's energy infrastructure can have both positive and negative impacts on our local economies, on public health, and environmental safety. Some of these impacts have been seen, unfortunately, negatively in my district. Some of you may know that in May of last year, an oil pipeline ruptured near the coast in my district, resulting in a spill that polluted the land and the adjoining water. This oil fouled our beaches, and they are key for recreation and tourism in the area, marred the pristine landscape, threatening the health of local plants and animals, as well as the economy of the region. Questions about the safety of local seafood forced fisheries to close, resulting in lost wages, uncertainty in this industry, which is critical to the economy and culture of California's Central Coast. Now, cleanup efforts have remediated much of the immediate impact, and fisheries have reopened, but we still have no idea what the long-term impacts will be. And while I know that the Air Survey Act that we're discussing today is focused on natural gas pipelines, the fact is that extraction, storage, and transportation of fossil fuels, whether oil or natural gas, this is a dirty and dangerous business. The ongoing Aliso Canyon natural gas leak just south of my district is a clear example of this danger. Not only is the methane from this leak significantly increasing the region's greenhouse gas emissions, it's leading to adverse health impacts, and it's forcing the relocation of nearby residents. So we must prioritize the health of our constituents, the safety of the environment, make sure we're working to ensure these priorities. One way to do that, of course, is to continue the push toward adopting clean, renewable energy. And while we do that, we must also ensure that we're doing all we can to ensure safest practices for the development operations of our nation's energy infrastructure until we can fully replace fossil fuels. Utilizing all the tools available to us when making decisions regarding public health and environmental safety makes a great deal of sense. However, I have several concerns regarding the replacement of one method with another when they may be fundamentally unable to produce the same results. My question to you, Mrs. Miles, it touches on what many have been asking about, but I want to zero in on the detail. Are aerial surveys able to identify all of the same details as ground surveys? For example, would aerial surveys be able to unequivocally state whether endangered or threatened species are present, or if the landscape is a seasonal wetland, something of this nature?
Thank you, Congresswoman. As I said, aerial surveys are not able to identify some particular resources in the detail that's needed to do an analysis and make a finding. And some of those that we have found that's the case to be endangered species, cultural resources, and it could be wetlands also.
Thank you. you know, my fear is that the language in this bill requires different survey methods to be given equal weight and allows for one method to functionally replace the other, regardless of equivalency. Furthermore, while I appreciate that this discussion addresses one aspect of energy infrastructure development, it is only the beginning of a much larger conversation we must have in this committee regarding not only pipeline siting, but also pipeline safety and supporting renewable energy technologies. Mr. Chairman, I do look forward to continuing to work with you and other efforts to improve our nation's energy infrastructure. Thank you very much, and I have no further questions. I'll yield back.
The gentlelady yields back. At this time, the chair recognizes the gentleman from West Virginia, Mr. McKinley, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Miles, if I could focus back on the five hydroelectric projects, doesn't seem to be any real issue with those. So I just wanted to look. I want to look a little bit more. Is this common to seek an extension? How common is that to occur for an extension under the Section 13?
I don't have any statistics on it, but we do get some requests.
I'm curious whether this is becoming more problematic. Do we need to do some things here to streamline the process to do that? You don't have an opinion on that then?
No, the one thing that I do see that's happening is we are issuing a lot more licenses for original construction of hydropower at existing dams. You know, 10 years ago, we were doing all relicensing. Right. So there is a lot of interest now in adding hydropower at existing dams, so there are more projects out there to go through the task of getting to construction.
Director, if they, if we didn't pass this, what would happen to the license? Would they have to start all over again?
Well, we would be required to terminate that license. It would expire, and they would have to begin again if the data is available and current enough. We would try to use as much as we possibly could, but we would need to go through the process with another public comment period.
It would delay the whole project, would it not?
It would delay construction, yes, to go through that process.
And I can remember about 3 years ago, we had a representative FERC here was talking about if we didn't start replacing some of the coal-fired power plants, particularly in the Mid-Atlantic, that we were going to see some rolling brownouts by next summer, mid-2017. So I think it's very imperative that we keep moving to try to make that replacement as long as it's available. So I thank you for your testimony, and I hope people will consider it without any more question of pushing these five projects. Thank you very much. Yield back the balance of my time.
The gentleman yields back. At this time, the chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Green, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and the ranking member for holding the hearing. I want to thank our witnesses for being here. Ms. Miles, it's clear from today's hearing that FERC has a lot on its plate. Currently, natural gas exports, pipelines, the LNG, hydropower reliability all fall under FERC. In addition to the House, the passed H.R. 8, which would expand FERC's permitting authorities to most of these sectors. In your position as Director of Office of Energy Projects, most of these issues fall in your office. Has the increased activity of the last few years affected your office? Have you required additional experts, or have you been able to make do with the existing personnel?
We regularly review our resources to make sure they match with our tasks before us, and we discuss with the chairman any needs for additional. We also use our contracting availability to help us with the peaks and valleys that are an inevitability of applications for pipelines, LNG, and hydropower projects.
Okay, we're on the horizon of another appropriation season. Does the Office of Energy Projects possess the resources to handle additional responsibility and activity, or do you need addition, or do you anticipate additional needs?
I think we're managing. as we are able, and that's something that I talk about with our chairman, and it comes in as our budget requests.
Okay. FERC occupies such a unique role of coordinating with all the federal agencies and state. Can you identify for us the top challenges facing you, the projects your office handles? What slows down the projects the most?
As I've said before, I think one of the most important things for the gas projects and actually for the hydro projects also is using our pre-filing process, that it can be extremely valuable if everyone is active during that time. The other thing that's very important is that the information that is needed for us to move forward and for other agencies also to do their permitting is collected during that pre-filing stage, so that when the application is filed, it's complete and we're able to notice and go right to our environmental document.
Let me follow up on that. Is there a particular federal agency or state agency that doesn't respond as timely? Because I know pre-filing helps a lot, but it still can be slowed down by agencies not getting back the information for you.
Right. I think, you know, we work really well to bring all the agencies to the table and during this pre-filing time and have regular conversations with them. Things vary from project to project in different parts of the country, so I can't speak to anyone in particular.
Okay. I know from Texas, obviously, we always have a lot of natural gas pipelines and cross-border with Mexico, because we're actually selling more gas to Mexico. And I was just wondering if there was a particular problem. As you know, this can be challenging and potentially when dealing with state and local officials that possess different points of view than the commission or the applicants. What remedial steps can FERC take as a coordinating agency if state and local officials do not cooperate in a timely fashion?
Well, we try to work with them to, if someone is not able to come to the table, to bring them to the table so they do participate. If not, we certainly make sure they understand how to participate in the process, and then we keep the process moving along.
So is there any problem with any individual of state that they may not get back with you as quick as they can or participate?
I can't speak to any in particular agency that is the case. You know, on one a project every now and then, we'll have to work a little harder at it.
And it could same be said about a federal agency, because you have to also coordinate all the federal agencies along with the state.
Yes, many of the federal agencies and state agencies who are carrying out federal authorizations are cooperating agencies with us in our environmental document, and that's a very good way to have simultaneous look at effects on all resources. So we encourage that, and most agencies are very interested in doing that.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back my
Chairman yields seconds. Back the 16 seconds. This time, I recognize the gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Griffith, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Now, Ms. Miles, I've listened to your testimony in regard to H.R. 3021, the Pompeo bill. I think what you're saying makes a lot of sense. I like aerial surveying in the first place, but I do think that some of my friends on the other side of the aisle raise some issues, and you've touched on it a little bit as well in regard to being able to identify everything on the ground, and you've indicated that there ought to be something before construction if we use an aerial survey, because you can't spot, you know, salamanders and certain small creatures or understory plants necessarily. You might spot areas that look like they might have that growth, but you can't do it. Is there anything in the bill that we need to change to make sure we get to where you want? I want to see the aerial surveying be equal, at least in the initial stages, as you've indicated you're fine with. But is there anything in the language that's currently proposed that we ought to change or look at in order to assure that we're also making sure that we don't overlook some important ecological asset?
I'm not looking at the bill this
yes, ma'am.
Moment, so and we would be happy, staff would be happy to work with the committee on that.
I think the one thing that I have commented on is that where ground access is available, currently we're finding that the companies, and they want to also, are providing that data. So that's an important point.
Well, and I agree with that. It's also good if you're trying to figure out where you want to put a line. I think it's quick. Particularly, you may see some problems if you're looking at siting a gas pipeline, that you can do that sometimes a lot faster in the air than you can on the ground. So there are advantages and disadvantages, I suppose, to both. In regard to H.R. 2984, Ms. Miles, I'm not going to ask you to comment. The Fair Rates Act, I would just have to say to Mr. Kennedy that I have a lot of constituents who are willing to dig coal, ship it to you by train or truck. We can lower your electric prices. We don't even need FERC action. What we may need is a little EPA action. But if we were allowed to, we could take care of your high rates for you.
You're a good man, my friend.
With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thanks, Mr. Griffith. At this time, I recognize the gentleman from Vermont, Mr. Welch, for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for being here and helping us. I want to just talk a little bit about the Kennedy bill. It seems like it's just a bizarre legalistic mistake that there can be no appeal when the statute essentially was designed to give the ratepayers an opportunity to appeal. Are there any policy reasons that would suggest what the Kennedy bill is proposing would in any way interfere with the capacity of FERC to carry out its responsibilities? I guess I'll ask you that, Mr. Mincer.
Well, the bill is aimed at a situation that, while it has occurred, is relatively unusual. It has not been a common occurrence that rates have changed without a commission order.
No, I get that, but it happens. So if you have, in this, the way it's working around here is that a lot of times we don't get the new person appointed, so we can have a 2-2 situation, not just in FERC, but otherwise. And the problems we have in trying to get a person confirmed, or the Senate has, shouldn't be the ratepayer problems, I think, is the point of the bill. And what I'm asking is that if this bill were passed, and then it meant that if it were a 2-2 decision, ratepayers would be able to do what they are now entitled to do if it were a 3-2 decision or a 5-0 decision, would that in any way compromise the responsibilities of FERC?
I think the only difficulty I foresee with the bill is one of reviewability or administrative functionality at the Court of Appeals. Right now, when an action goes up to the D.C. Circuit, they review the commission order and they review the action. The D.C. Circuit may have a more difficult challenge if there's nothing to review from the commission.
I don't understand it. If there's a 2-2 decision, there's a 2-2 decision, right?
That's not exactly right, Congressman. There's no commission action because it's 2-2. It is not a situation like you might see from the U.S. Supreme Court where there's an actual opinion with two votes on either side. Here, it just takes effect and there isn't a decision. And that would be the difficulty in administrative review. The Court of Appeals wouldn't have anything to look at. I do think that's a difficulty that could be overcome. But
right.
If you were concerned
by writing
about
a decision or having the two right there decision and the two right theirs. So there would then be something to review.
When it has happened in the past, there is simply no commission order. There's nothing on either side.
No, I get that, and I think the effort here is to try to provide that opportunity, because it just seems kind of bizarre, whichever side of the case you're on, that you've got a statutory right to appeal unless it's deadlocked at 2-2. So, all right. Let me just go on to the second thing. So anyway, Mr. Kennedy, thank you for that legislation, which I hope we can all support. The Supreme Court decision on demand response, from my point of view, is a tremendous tool that's going to help FERC try to help ratepayers keep their costs down. Can you talk, Ms. Miles, I guess, a little bit about that, or Mr. Mincer, and how you see that as being a useful tool for FERC in trying to address ratepayer concerns? And that's commercial and individual.
Sure, I can answer that question. The Supreme Court largely agreed with the Commission's argument that there is Commission jurisdiction to allow demand response to participate in the wholesale electric markets, and that is something the Commission has done in the past. In my view, demand response can be an effective tool
at helping keep rates down by allowing the opportunity to avoid paying high-priced energy at peak times.
Right. You know, in our largest utility, Mr. Chairman, Green Mountain Power is a strong supporter of demand response, and our utility users seem to be very happy with it, and that includes some of our major companies. So keep up the good work on that.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman yields back. This time, Chair recognizes the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Johnson, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank the panel for being with us today as well. I represent a district in southeastern Ohio that borders the Ohio River, the Muskingum River. We've got a lot of hydropower potential there. I want to kind of take off on something that Representative McKinley said. You know, given that so many projects miss the 2-year and 4-year statutory deadlines, often due to issues that are beyond the project's control and the applicant's control, perhaps it makes sense to update the Federal Power Act to either provide FERC with greater discretion on setting those deadlines, maybe more flexible deadlines, or to increase the number of years that an applicant can have to commence construction. Does FERC have an opinion on that?
I'm speaking only for myself, given that, however, the chairman and former chairman have said up to 10 years was all right. If FERC had that authority to just do it itself, then folks would not need to come to Congress. So.
Right. Well, okay. Well, that's good to know, because we certainly need to work that, because with the plethora of federal regulations and environmental studies and all kinds of things that applicants have to go through, it's lengthened out these project timelines to get all of this stuff approved. So I appreciate that. Ms. Miles, as you're aware, the committee is keenly interested in supporting new energy infrastructure projects. One of the opportunities we see is in the hydropower sector, specifically adding generation to existing non-powered dams. We have some of those in Ohio. And that's what we're talking about as part of today's hearing. So these low-impact renewable and clean energy resources, that's what they are important. Yet we continue to hear of problems getting projects approved, financed, and built, particularly in comparison to other energy projects. So what is your view on these opportunities with hydropower adding power generation to existing dam structures, and what is the reason we've not seen more of these type projects built?
My view is that there is a lot of hydropower potential in the U.S. at existing dams. I think the Department of Energy has issued reports to that effect.
What's the holdup?
I think that we have worked very hard with the other agencies who need to issue permits on those projects to be able to move them through the process expeditiously while being thorough and fair and addressing all resource areas.
Do you see it as a FERC issue? Is it a core issue? And is there anything that FERC can do? And more importantly, is there anything Congress can do that would help move these projects along more quickly?
I think that the issue is really trying to work through these things simultaneously, or everybody working at it together. And that does vary depending on agencies that we're working with at these projects.
Let me make sure I understand what you're saying. So you're saying that, and I'm paraphrasing, so you're saying that sometimes these projects become serial, agency to agency to agency, rather than parallel agencies.
Correct.
moving things along collaboratively. How do we solve that problem?
Well, we have been working with the other agencies where we...
So you do think it needs to be solved?
That is an issue.
frankly, I mean, we have worked with the Corps of Engineers quite a lot on this. We have a memorandum of understandings for how we will work together, and we're in the process right now of working further with them on how to have our processes work well together.
But it's clearly it's clearly still a slow process, and my time is up. I'm going to have to yield back. Is it safe to say you agree that we need to do better collaboration between the agencies to parallel these things where we can? Is that what I'm hearing you saying?
Yes, at projects where that's not happening now, yes.
All right. Thank you very much, and I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. This time, Chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Flores, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Miles, we talked a few minutes ago about the about electricity rates in the Northeast being among the highest in the country. Can you tell me why that is? What's the reason for that?
I can't speak to that. You want to speak to it?
I can speak to that only in the most general sense. Your electric rates vary across the country for a wide range of reasons. I don't think there's a specific reason.
What would the top two or three reasons be?
It's really a mix of the location of generation and load across the country. So it's frankly the intersection of supply and demand of energy.
Okay. And so part of it could be the fuel sources that they are restricted to use, correct? I mean, Mr. Griffith sort of touched on this a few minutes ago. If there were more infrastructure to get natural gas pipelines in the Northeast, that they could have natural gas-fired electricity generation, wouldn't they be better off? Wouldn't that solve a lot of the rate issues?
I'm not sure I can speak specifically to that question.
Ms. Miles, can you speak to that?
I can't either.
I was going to say, I can answer it for you. The answer is yes. And so I think that's the reason the aerial survey bill is very important to look at. Now, I do agree there, you've got to have ground surveys as well, but I think the aerial surveys help with the initial siting and so forth. This is something I think you need to take a look at. You know, how can the Northeast, how can New England be helped with their electricity rates? And the best thing is for better infrastructure. So I'd ask you to think about that as you're going through your permitting planning process in the future. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. This time the chair recognizes the gentleman. Mr. Barton, did you want to ask questions? Or? Okay. Mr. Hudson of North Carolina is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this important hearing. Thank you to our panel for participating. I'm proud to be a co-sponsor of Representative Pompeo's bill to amend Section 203 of the Federal Power Act, as well as Representative Kennedy's Fair Rates Act. I'm also glad to see Representative Fox's bill move forward regarding the Carr-Scott Hydropower Project in Wilkes County, North Carolina. These are common sense bills, and Mr. Chairman, I appreciate you bringing them before this subcommittee. To get to my questions, I'd like to build on the line of questioning my colleague Mr. Johnson raised dealing with hydroelectric power. Ms. Miles, you note in your testimony that FERC has generally taken the position of not opposing legislation that would extend the commencement of construction deadline no further than 10 years from the day that license in question was issued. So because each of the hydro bills before us today provides for commencement of construction deadlines that do not exceed 10 years from the dates the respective licenses were issued, is it true that FERC does not oppose any of these bills?
Yes, we do not. I do not.
Thank you. Historically, hydropower has played a primary energy storage role, with hydro pump storage currently providing 97% of energy storage in the U.S. What is your view on energy storage and pump storage in particular?
Pump storage does provide considerable grid scale storage, and it can be very valuable. We have noticed an increase in applications for pump storage projects, especially in areas where there is a lot of wind and solar projects.
Well, what are the market issues that need to be addressed to support development of new pump storage, and what can FERC do either by itself or working with state PUCs or in the ISOs, RTOs?
I'm not really able to speak to market issues. Our primary responsibility is to analyze the projects that come before us in a very thorough, fair, and scientifically sound way, and to have a process that allows us to do that.
I appreciate that. Have there been any issues working with state POCs and others that could be addressed or better handled either through your agency or things that we could do to support that?
The state POCs typically do not are not involved with us as we do the environmental review and licensing of those kinds of projects, action on those kinds of projects.
Okay. Would you agree that FERC has a significant level of expertise and experience in analyzing environmental effects of hydro projects under its jurisdiction?
Yes.
Does FERC currently employ biologists and other scientific experts to provide guidance on analyzing environmental effects of hydro projects?
Yes, our resources, we have experts in each resource area that we analyze.
And what's the number and experience of the staff administering the licensing and regulation of hydro projects, the number of PhDs, master's degrees, et cetera?
I can't give you the specific number, but we do have many of our staff have master's degrees, some have PhDs.
If you could provide us that list.
The list of which do, certainly.
Be great. And master's degrees, just you know what the expertise levels are.
Certainly.
Be great. Regarding the FERC hydropower licensing generally, do you agree that the licensing processes could be shortened if the commission had the ability to set enforceable deadlines and coordinate the other federal and state approval involved?
I didn't come prepared really to testify on, I think you're getting at HR 8, and however, I have spoken in the past that enforceable deadlines can be, I'm gonna move back and say I didn't come prepared, but we'd be happy to answer questions.
Okay, I'd appreciate that.
Sure.
You can provide us with an answer. All right, Mr. Chairman, that exhausts my line of questioning. I will yield back. Thank you.
Gentleman yields back. At this time, Chair recognizes the gentleman from Mississippi, Mr. Harper, 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thanks to you witnesses for being here. And just a comment, Ms. Miles, I believe you addressed it earlier with Mr. Johnson, but just as a side note, it's my understanding that 4 new hydro projects have been approved in Mississippi, and we appreciate FERC's diligence in those matters. Mr. Menzner, you state in your testimony that the legislation to amend Section 203 of the Federal Power Act could ease the administrative burden on the commission staff and the regulatory burden on the industry without a significant negative impact on the commission's regulatory responsibilities. Can you please elaborate or briefly expand on these potential benefits of the legislation?
Thank you, Congressman. On the burden side, certainly every 203 filing requires review by commission staff and action by the commission through some sort of order. A de minimis threshold would mean that for those falling below the $10 million level, the commission would not need to take that action. And similarly, on the side of industry, they would not need to make the initial filing, which would ease their burden. In terms of the effect on the regulatory program, the filings that come in for mergers or consolidations of smaller facilities, those below the $10 million, are ones that are less likely to impose potential consequences on rates or on competition.
Great. Thank you. With the interest of time, Mr. Chairman, I'll yield back.
The gentleman yields back. At this time, I want you all to know we're not trying to discriminate against Mr. Kennedy. He's a member of the Energy and Commerce Committee, but he's not a member of this subcommittee. And even though we're considering one of his bills today, he's patiently waited until everyone else has asked questions. So this time, I recognize Mr. Kennedy for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very, very much. I appreciate the opportunity to join you and squat in on the Energy and Power Subcommittee, and appreciate the kind words from my colleagues on the other side of the aisle and the offer for bulk purchasing of coal, Mr. Griffith. Very, very well noted. Thank you. And to the rest of my colleagues as well, thank you. Mr. Minzer, a couple of questions for you, sir, to begin with. You mentioned in your testimony that Section 205 of the Federal Power Act includes a 60-day clock for review in which FERC will take action. Can you discuss what requirements the Commission has within those 60 days, and does FERC have an affirmative requirement to actually act?
The statute does not require the Commission to act. However, the Commission typically does take action on the filing by approving it, denying it, or requesting additional information from the utility. The consequences, though, if the Commission does not act in that time period, is the rates do take effect.
And I know you're well aware, obviously, of what happened in New England in 2014 with that forward capacity auction number 8 and a deadlock commissioned. You mentioned in your testimony that, in response to questions, that that's an exceedingly rare occurrence. Does that only occur when there are 4 commissioners present, or has it happened when there's an odd number of commissioners as well?
Rates have taken effect not solely as a result of a 2-2 split of the commission. In fact, under the Federal Power Act, the situation you mentioned at ISO New England, I believe is only the second time that I'm aware of that it's happened as a result of a 2-2 split. It's happened under other occasions.
And though, can you just shine some light on what those other occasions, if you can recall what those other occasions were?
We don't know the reason for all of them. On one occasion, the commission stated the rates took effect inadvertently because a commission failure to act.
Okay. Given that the commission is currently down to 4 commissioners, what tools does the commission have to avoid a deadlock on any rate change filed across the country? I realize that most changes are non-controversial and unlikely to result in a deadlock anyway, but this outcome is certainly obviously not impossible. Before we can hopefully get this bill across the finish line, what options are available to FERC to provide proper access to administrative and judicial review for ratepayers? There's, as you're well aware, an auction set to take place in New England next week. And given the fact that there are 4, another commissioner's notice his intent to retire, no other nomination is currently in the pipeline. What, if anything, is FERC, tools does FERC have to make sure we don't end up in the same place?
I know the commission staff and the commissioners are very dedicated to working collaboratively to reaching outcomes that can have the support of a majority of the commissioner. And I think certainly the commission has endeavored to do that in the past and has effectively managed to reach a majority vote on almost every occasion.
But there's nothing, and I appreciate that and I understand that, but has there been any specific policy change or internal to FERC where with 4 commissioners, in the advent of a hearing having to go through with 4 commissioners and that notice being put forth, that there would be some sort of review, provided that this bill doesn't make it to the president's desk by the time that those commission results need, or the auction results need to be certified?
In my view, under the current version of the Federal Power Act, if the commission does not act as a result of a 2-2 split or otherwise, there would not be rehearing or appellate review available under the current statutory framework. Other than working to reach a consensus in a majority vote, I'm not aware of other internal policy changes.
Okay. Thank you. I'll yield back.
Gentleman yields back, and that concludes the questions for the first panel. Ms. Miles and Mr. Menzner, thank you for being with us, and we look forward to working with you as we continue our efforts on all of this legislation. This time I'd like to call up the witnesses on the second panel. If you all would come and have a seat. And I know that Mr. Kennedy is going to be introducing one of our witnesses, so I'll call on him to make that introduction at this time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I am pleased to introduce a fellow member of Massachusetts that has come down on relatively short notice to join us here today. Mr. Battigi, who runs the Braintree
power plant, a municipal power plant, who has a deep knowledge in how our energy systems work in Massachusetts, how our capacity markets work, and the intricacies surrounding our the increase of cost that we've seen in recent history in Massachusetts. He's one of the few people I have found, Mr. Chairman, on this planet that can actually explain this in language that people understand, to which I am eternally, or for which I am eternally grateful. Sir, we are grateful to have you here. Look forward to your testimony and the light that you can shine on how things are working and how they are not working in Massachusetts and across the country. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction, and I'll at this time introduce the other members of this panel. First, we have Mr. Timothy Powell, who is the Director of Land, GIS, and Permits at the Williams Company. We have Mr. Edward Lloyd, who is the Evan Frankel Clinical Professor of Environmental Law at Columbia University School of Law, and he's here today on behalf of the New Jersey Conservation Foundation and the Stony Brook Millstone Watershed Association. We also have Mr. Bill Marson, who is Executive Vice President, General Counsel, and Corporate Secretary of the American Transmission Company. We have Mr. Tyson Slocum, who's the Energy Program Director of Public Citizen, Inc. And then we have Mr. Jeffrey Leahy, who is the Deputy Executive Director for the National Hydropower Association. Thank all of you for taking time of your very busy schedules for being with us today. I'm going to call on each one of you, and you'll be given 5 minutes for your opening statements. And be sure and pull the microphone close and make sure the microphone is on. And Mr. Powell, we'll recognize you first for your opening statement.
Thank you, sir.
5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member, and members of the subcommittee, my name is Tim Powell, and I am the Director of Land, GIS, and Permits for the Williams Companies. I'm also appearing today on behalf of the Interstate Natural Gas Association of America, the industry association representing the interstate natural gas pipeline industry. Mr. Chairman, I appear today to support House Resolution 3021, introduced by Representative Pompeo and co-sponsored by Representatives Mullen, Schrader, and Meeks, which endeavors to address a permitting challenge facing jurisdictional pipelines, which I shall explain. We thank the committee for including a version of that language as part of H.R. 8. FERC has long served as a lead agency for considering pipeline applications pursuant to the Natural Gas Act. In Section 313 of the Energy Policy Act, this committee and this Congress instructed federal and state agencies involved in the process to cooperate with the FERC and comply with the permitting schedule established by the Commission. However, the permit process followed by some Corps of Engineer districts and corresponding state agencies pursuant to their Clean Water Act responsibilities can cause them to fail to meet the FERC schedule, resulting in permit delays. This is most notable when the agencies deem they have insufficient field survey data to initiate their review. These processes are not required by the Clean Water Act and could be modified to better conform with the FERC schedule. That is the goal of this legislation. Often the first time an affected landowner has face-to-face contact with the company is when an agent's knocking on their door and asking that landowner to sign a form, giving the company permission to begin performing field surveys. These data are used to support the NEPA review, identify the least damaging alternative, determine constructability, and obtain other permits and approvals, such as those required by the Clean Water Act. Many landowners elect to participate in the process, but some elect to exercise their right to deny permission. In my experience, Williams receives approximately 70 to 80% survey permission prior to the certificate filing. For various reasons, the remaining landowners either delay survey approval or outright deny it. Williams and other INGA member companies fully respect each landowner's right to decide if and how they participate in the project. The problem is that some Corps of Engineer districts and state agencies with 401 water quality certification responsibility will require an applicant to conduct up to 100% field survey in order to deem a permit application complete. In other cases, the Corps and responsible state agency will begin processing applications, but will not make a decision without a 100% field survey. This approach is not required, and indeed, in some cases, the agencies will accept the best available data and move forward with condition permit decisions. If an agency is to require a percentage of field survey beyond which the company can obtain in order to deem an application complete, the company is placed in a classic catch-22 situation. The FERC process anticipates that companies will submit applications for federal approvals prior to or concurrent with the application for a certificate. Typically, the time between a certificate filing and an order is around 1 year. This is the same timeline that an agency administering the 401 water quality certification has to act once they deem an application complete. These two timelines can only align if the 401 application is deemed complete and runs in parallel to the certificate proceeding. The solution is to direct all other agencies involved in issuing federal authorizations to accept data gathered by means other than on-the-ground surveys. If the agency elects, any permits issued based on remote sensing could be conditioned upon ground survey verification once access has been obtained. This is an important point and bears emphasizing. If the agency deems it necessary, no ground disturbance would occur on remote sense tracks prior to verifying that data by on-the-ground survey. Non-field survey data gather methods may include satellite photography, sensors attached to fixed wing aircraft, helicopter, aerial photography, previous mapping, or by studying the area from accessible locations. The proposal solution has a number of obvious benefits. It allows pipeline companies and regulators to assess likely impacts and make informed decisions, aligns the certificate proceeding with other federal reviews, and allows FERC to effectively fulfill its lead agency mandate while minimizing the adversarial relationship between landowners and the pipeline company when agencies require more ground survey than property owners want to provide. In summary, Mr. Chairman, we believe the legislation being discussed is a win-win for all involved in the permitting process, and we urge its adoption.
Thank you very much. Mr. Lloyd, you're recognized for 5 minutes for your opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and ranking member and members of the committee. I take a different view than the last witness. Unfortunately, I don't think that the aerial surveys are going to solve the problem that we all want to solve. The data scientists for the New Jersey Conservation Foundation have looked at 1,000 plant and animal species in New Jersey that would have to be surveyed under Endangered Species Act and other rare and specified species. And we found that less than 1% of those species can be identified with aerial surveys. So that the problem is that if we begin to rely on aerial surveys, especially in the pre-filing process, we're going to have to go back and verify. And to me, at the end of the day, it's going to delay the process, not expedite it. I think all of us want the best data we can have. The problem is that aerial surveys, by and large, are not going to get us the data that we need to do the proper analysis by the agency. Of the 1,000 species we looked at, there were only 1% that actually could be identified by aerial surveys. So it means we're going to have to go on the ground and ground truth it. And this could lead to, if we don't do it up front, it could lead to having to revisit. If we go to verification, then we have to revisit those surveys. We may have to change the pipeline route. It's not efficient for any of us. So we would suggest that the aerial surveys are really not solving a problem, and in fact may create more delay and drain more resources from the agency. The other thing I wanted to mention is the impact on landowners. In New Jersey, we've already experienced the use of aerial surveys. We've had a number of complaints from landowners that they've been disturbing, especially in rural areas, livestock, and the peaceful privacy of homeowners. So aerial surveys can have unintended negative consequences for homeowners, and I think we have to be very careful about how quickly we want to authorize those aerial surveys in place of the ground surveys, which give us much better data, and in fact, I think the data that's needed for the agency. Finally, I just want to mention, we've seen, as this committee has heard this morning, a proliferation of pipeline proposals. There are now 80 pending proposals before FERC. We would highly recommend that FERC begin to look at these instead of as individual pipelines, look at these on a regional basis. I think a programmatic environmental impact statement is one way to address that, where again, it would save agency resources if we look at these pipelines together on a programmatic basis. And then there may be additional individual pipeline analyses we need to do, but the programmatic EIS would enhance our decision-making process, would enhance FERC's ability to make these analyses, and it would save resources for the companies and for FERC. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Bottigy, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman Whitfield, Ranking Member Rush, and members of the committee, thank you for inviting me to speak at today's hearing. I also wish to extend a particular thanks to Congressman Kennedy for his work bringing attention to the problems with the forward capacity market in New England and for inviting me to speak today. I'm Bill Bottigy, the General Manager of the Braintree Electric Light Department, Braintree Electric is a nonprofit municipal utility owned by the residents of Braintree, Massachusetts. Our service territory is limited to just the town of Braintree, and we've been providing highly reliable electric service at the lowest reasonable rates since 1892 to the residents and businesses in Braintree. Braintree Electric belongs to the Northeast Public Power Association, NEPA, which represents municipal utilities in six New England states. I'm testifying on behalf of NEPA, but my views today are my own. Braintree Electric also belongs to the American Public Power Association, in which I'm on the board of directors. These remarks are also a top priority of the American Public Power Association and the 48 million customers that they serve. My remarks today will be focused on the forward capacity market and the Fair Rates Act, H.R. 2984. Deregulation. In the 1990s in New England and Massachusetts, deregulation of electric utility markets occurred, transitioning the historically vertically integrated utility markets, the utilities, to a centralized competitive market for wholesale power. The belief was that forcing investor-owned utilities to sell their generation assets would result in the private development of newly high-efficient generation in a competitive market, driving down the cost of electricity. Well, thousands of megawatts of generation, all natural gas, was built in the early 2000s. Surprisingly, though, the existing generation, which was purchased from the investor-owned utilities, did not retire as expected, and that created a large surplus of generation in New England. The primary revenue stream at the time, this is before the forward capacity market started, was payments for the electricity that the generators produced. With a surplus of generating capacity, some plants were not running frequently enough to provide their owners with the revenue they needed to cover their fixed costs. As a result, there were several bankruptcies. A lot of the new plants declared bankruptcy because they had the high debt service to cover, and they weren't getting the revenue they needed to cover that. So ISO New England recognized the markets were not working and implemented the forward capacity market starting in 2007 with FERC approval. Unlike the energy market, where power plants bid their marginal costs into ISO New England, and they ISO called on the cheapest units to run first, these markets provided capacity payments to the generators in exchange for having a physical resource available to run, for just being there. Capacity prices were set and are still set today based on the need for new generation. With a surplus of generation capacity, capacity prices stayed low from the first auction held in 2007 through the seventh auction held in 2013, and it's a forward auction, so that seventh auction is taking place starting in June of 2016 for 1 year. Meanwhile, municipal utilities, Braintree Electric's one of them, were carved out from deregulation in the 1990s, and we were allowed to self-supply our own generation. We were left vertically integrated. We didn't have to sell our power plants. We were allowed to provide our own capacity to our own customers. Self-supply allowed municipal utilities to build generation. That way we could cover our own capacity needs. Braintree Electric built 115 megawatts of quick start gas-fired oil backup generation in 2009 under this self-supply provision, giving us price certainty for our capacity for a long time in the future. This provided us and other municipal utilities with our ability to cover our own capacity costs, so we weren't dependent on the forward capacity auction, which creates a lot of variability in capacity costs, as you've seen in my written testimony. Unfortunately, as our needs for capacity have grown, we're unable to self-supply our own capacity. In 2013, ISO New England petitioned the FERC, who removed the right for municipal utilities like Braintree Electric to provide their own capacity, their own self-supply. They thought we exerted too much buyer-side market power. So where are we today? In 2014, the eighth forward capacity auction was held, and that was the first auction where new generation was needed. That big surplus that was created at the start of deregulation was gone. Part of that was Vermont Yankee, Brayton Point, Norwalk Harbor, and many other older plants finally were retiring for reliability reasons and environmental reasons. These retirements in that one auction cycle totaled 4,300 megawatts of electricity, and only 1,500 megawatts of new generation cleared that auction. So that created an imbalance, driving up the cost of capacity payments to an administrated cap by ISO New England to $15 a kilowatt month. So as a reference, previous to that, it was $3 a kilowatt month. So prices jumped in one auction fivefold, from $3 to $15, which is what Congressman Kennedy references happened in 2000 and in that auction, full capacity auction number 8. Some believe the closure of Brayton Point manipulated the market, causing a shortage of capacity, driving up capacity payments for all generation, including the fleet of plants in addition to Brayton Point that was also owned by that same company. All told, capacity starting in 2018 will cost New England consumers $4 billion a year, up from $1 billion a year in 2016. So from 2016 to 2018, prices are quadrupling. That translates into $21 a month on the average residential electric bill, just for the capacity portion, not all the other components that have gone up as well. This dramatic increase demonstrates how dysfunctional a market is and should have presented an opportunity for the FERC to investigate the last-minute closure of Brayton Point. And as we've been discussing earlier today, due to FERC's vacancy, the one commissioner vacancy, they were unable to investigate because they had that 2-2 tie in the vote. And it was ordered a rule of law, and the rate was enacted. So the Fair Rates Act is an important piece of legislation because it would make the same administrative review procedures currently approved by the commission applicable to rates that just take effect by law, by operation of law. Many of us would like to see an investigation into what happened in the 8th forward capacity auction, and those in public power would like to see the capacity markets fundamentally reformed, including our right to self-supply so we could provide our own generation to our own customers. However, this, while it's a narrow step, is a critical first step. This bill will ensure that if the FERC is deadlocked again in the future over questionable rates, the problem does not reoccur in New England or other regions. With this act, ratepayers will now have an avenue to challenge unfair rates. So in conclusion, I want to thank Congressman Kennedy for introducing the bill and the committee for holding this hearing on what can be a confusing topic, confusing subject. On behalf of Braintree Electric, NEPA, and APPA, and myself, I hope the committee will continue to examine mandatory capacity markets throughout New England and the rest of the country. Mm-hmm. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And Mr. Marzan, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Rush, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to testify today in support of legislation to amend Section 203 of the Federal Power Act and make the law work as intended. I'm Executive Vice President, General Counsel at American Transmission Company. We construct, own, and operate electric transmission property in Wisconsin and the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, as well as a hold ownership interest in transmission property in California. ATC is a transmission-only utility, which was formed in 2001 when other utility companies transferred their transmission assets to create the new company. This formative transaction was subject to Section 203 of the Power Act. Subsequent to our formation, ATC has continued to acquire utility property subject to FERC's Section 203 regulation. The Energy Policy Act of 2005 amended Section 203 to increase the dollar threshold from $50,000 to $10 million of FERC's authority to pre-approve dispositions by public utilities of jurisdictional utility facilities. FERC's regulations and orders implementing this change have failed to account for congressional intent. Specifically, FERC has relied on apparent oversight in the text of the statute to reverse its own decades-old application of the minimum monetary threshold, finding the new Section 203 eliminated the monetary threshold entirely for acquisitions or mergers of jurisdictional facilities. This has led to some absurd results. For example, FERC has required pre-approval pursuant to Section 203 for the $1 purchase of 10 miles of depreciated transmission line, as well as the purchase of an electrical disconnect switch and associated wiring for $10. Conversely, the sellers of the same equipment I just described were not required to make any filings with FERC at all. FERC's interpretation requires prior approval for the acquisition of utility property that has any monetary value attached to it or no monetary value at all. FERC's interpretation frustrates the intent of the amendment to Section 203 in EPAC 2005. Congress intended to reduce the regulatory burden on utilities by raising the threshold of the FERC pre-approval, and Congress did this with good reason. Public utilities regularly buy and sell utility assets that have minimal impact on the bulk electric system and do not affect FERC's ability to regulate. The prior threshold of $50,000 made no sense in 2005, and let alone today's economy. Congress sensibly raised the threshold to $10 million in order to spare utilities the administrative cost of the pre-approval process for small transactions, while maintaining FERC's oversight on transactions with the potential to impact utility operations and rates. FERC's current interpretation of Section 203 has imposed a new and unnecessary regulatory burden on public utilities. It has also increased the risk that public utilities will be targeted by the FERC Office of Enforcement for violations of Section 203. At least one such FERC enforcement action for failure to receive pre-approval for relatively de minimis acquisitions has been resolved, and is reasonable to expect more. FERC has refused requests to revise its regulations to conform with the intent of EPAC 2005 and has made it clear that only a statutory change to Section 203 will force a shift in FERC policy. On December 3, 2015, the House passed H.R. 8, the North American Energy Security and Infrastructure Act of 2015. Section 3222 of H.R. 8 clarifies Section 203 to expressly include a monetary threshold of greater than $10 million for FERC pre-approval of mergers and acquisitions of jurisdictional utility property, just as Congress intended when it passed EPAC 2005. This change would serve at least three important purposes. It would make Section 203 internally consistent, it would give clear instruction to FERC about its pre-approval authority, and it would relieve an unnecessary regulatory burden on public utilities. The bill before the subcommittee today adopts the language of Section 3222 of H.R. 8 as a standalone measure. ATC strongly supports this legislation. On behalf of ATC, I want to thank the subcommittee for inviting me to testify, and I stand ready to answer any questions the members may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Slocum, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Chairman Whitfield, Ranking Member Rush, members of the committee. My name is Tyson Slocum, and I direct the energy program at Public Citizen. Public Citizen is a national, nonprofit, nonpartisan consumer advocacy organization funded in part by the more than 400,000 members and supporters we have across the country. In my capacity as Energy Program Director, I serve on the United States Commodity Futures Trading Commission Energy and Environmental Markets Advisory Committee, and I also frequently intervene and comment in a number of FERC proceedings. So I'm here to talk about two pieces of legislation. One is the bill that would exempt from FERC review any merger consolidation under $10 million, and the second is the Fair Rates Act, H.R. 2984. So on the legislation that would extend a $10 million threshold to exempt mergers and consolidations, on the face of it, that might seem reasonable. But when you understand the way that energy markets operate, you quickly understand that it's not necessarily the dollar value of a transaction, but what the impact of that facility has on the operation of an energy market. And with power facilities, these are known as what's known as pivotal suppliers. And in two landmark market manipulation cases that I have brought before FERC that are still under review, it was either one power plant in the case of New England or a very small collection of power plants that, had it been a merger or consolidation, very likely would have been under that $10 million threshold. And so it is very important that Congress retain the language that was plainly included in the Energy Policy Act of 2005. Because remember, the Energy Policy Act of 2005 repealed one of the landmark utility regulations in this country, the Public Utility Holding Company Act of 1935. And as part of that agreement to repeal that long-standing utility regulation, Congress was very aware of the need to ensure that FERC had full authority over all mergers and consolidations. And that's why they explicitly did not include that threshold dollar figure in the plain language of the Energy Policy Act of 2005. So on the second piece of legislation, the Fair Rates Act, H.R. 2984, this is a great piece of legislation that directly addresses a market manipulation case that I brought before FERC in 2014 that's been much talked about at today's hearing, the 2014 Ford capacity auction in ISO New England. We made an allegation in our FERC filing that a Cayman Islands-based private equity firm named Energy Capital Partners had acquired a fleet of power plants in New England, and 6 weeks after closing on that transaction, announced the retirement of one of them, and that retirement moved the New England market from a surplus to a deficit, thereby triggering a significant price increase by about $1 billion in that auction. We filed our market manipulation complaint saying that their actions were the subject of market manipulation and that the resulting rates were unjust and unreasonable. And as has been explained, FERC deadlocked 2-2 on my complaint, and so they did not set for hearing whether or not to consider if the rates were lawful. Instead, they issued this notice that the rates had become effective by operation of law. We asked for rehearing. FERC denied our rehearing. We then filed a petition to review in federal court. FERC made a motion to dismiss. The court did not grant FERC's motion to dismiss, and we have filed initial briefs and reply briefs, and that the court is actively considering this reviewability question. It's clear that the Fair Rates Act of H.R. 2984 would help alleviate this problem if it were to occur in the future, and that's why Public Citizen supports that legislation. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Leahy, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Whitfield, Ranking Member Rush, and members of the subcommittee. I am Jeffrey Leahy, Deputy Executive Director of the National Hydropower Association, and I'm pleased to be here to discuss legislation to reinstate and extend the deadline for the commencement of construction for 5 licensed hydropower projects and how these projects demonstrate new growth potential we see in the hydropower industry. The U.S. hydropower fleet is made up of 2,200 plants with a capacity of almost 80 gigawatts. These plants provide roughly 7% of all electricity and close to half of all renewable electricity, making hydropower the largest provider of renewable power in the United States. Hydropower's contributions to the electric grid are many: baseload power, peaking power, load following, energy storage, reliability, and more. Because of the need for more of these services, the industry has grown in recent years. In fact, the U.S. experienced a net capacity increase of 1.4 gigawatts from 2005 to 2013, enough to power over 500,000 homes. A prime growth area is on existing infrastructure, such as non-power dams and conduits. The projects today showcase these opportunities. 2 would add generation to Bureau of Reclamation dams, 2 to Army Corps of Engineers dams, and another dam owned by New York City. They are all small projects ranging from 4 to 15 megawatts, and together they will add 51.7 megawatts to the system, enough to power close to 21,000 homes. Of the 80,000 dams in the United States, only 3% have electric generating facilities. The vast majority were built for other purposes: water supply, navigation, irrigation. The Department of Energy recognized this untapped potential on non-power dams and in 2012 released a report of these projects. The map you see on the screens depicts the size and locations of the top prospects. The study showed that 12 gigawatts of total potential, with 8 gigawatts available at the top 100 sites alone. 81 of the top 100 sites were located on Corps of Engineers dams. These types of projects, including the 5 here today, are some of the lowest impact developments in the energy sector. No new dams need to be built, and the projects aim to utilize existing flows. What better way to maximize the benefit of this infrastructure by also generating renewable carbon-free power? These projects can face a variety of obstacles that push back construction timelines, thus requiring the action that the subcommittee is taking today. Speaking generally, these include delays in post-licensing construction approvals, refinements in project design, negotiations on power purchase agreements, and others. To begin, hydropower has the most complex development timeline of any renewable resource. It can take 10 years or longer from the start of licensing through construction to being placed in service. It also requires considerable upfront financial commitment from the developer for the studies needed for federal and state approvals. Water is a public resource, and NHA recognizes the need for thorough review of new project applications. However, the overall process can also be a factor for delays in moving to start of construction. For example, when adding generating facilities to non-powered federal dams, FERC may issue a license, yet that project cannot start construction until it receives additional approvals from the federal dam owner. If there are unanticipated delays for those approvals, no work can commence. NHA notes that the House passed HR8 and the Senate is debating S-2012 energy bills that contain bipartisan provisions to address inefficiencies and improve coordination in the hydropower process. We note the Water Resources Reform and Development Act of 2014 provided direction to the Corps to prioritize hydro development and complete permitting in a timely and consistent manner. Also, S-2012 specifically aims to address the issue at hand today. It contains a provision allowing applicants to receive an extension of the commenced construction deadline for up to 8 additional years. NHA strongly supports all of these efforts. Further, design changes for projects at federal facilities can result from discussions with the federal owners as developers move to construction. Working cooperatively, developers must show the final construction plans will not interfere with the original purposes of the federal dam and also not harm its integrity. There have been instances where design changes were proposed post-licensing and pre-construction that differed from the design that was originally licensed. As such, more consultation was needed between the developer, FERC, and the federal owner to approve these changes. Lastly, industry members also report difficulty securing power purchase agreements. In testimony before the subcommittee last year, Cube Hydro, a developer, stated that regulatory uncertainty and risk of delays can negatively impact acquiring PPAs, and that failure to obtain one, in turn, inhibits the ability to obtain project financing. This can include post-licensing financing to cover construction costs, which can also impede the ability to meet the start construction deadline. To conclude, hydropower projects have a critical role to play in meeting our nation's energy, climate, and economic development objectives. The five projects the subcommittee considers today are prime examples of the tremendous growth potential at existing water infrastructure across the country. It is NHA's hope that the time granted by these extensions allow the projects to complete the process and protect the significant investment of time and financial resources, both by the developers and also the federal government. I thank the subcommittee for inviting me to testify, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Leahy, and thank all of you for your opening statements. At this time, I'll recognize myself for 5 minutes of questions. Mr. Bottigy and Mr. Slocum, let me ask you, the Cayman Group that purchased these power plants in the Northeast, how many did they purchase and what did they pay for? What was the purchase price?
I can't remember the exact number of power plants. I believe it was a deal that included, I think, 5 or 6 total power plants in 2 different geographic markets, in PJM and in ISO New England. I don't know if there was a public purchase price because Energy Capital Partners as a private equity firm doesn't have to submit Securities and Exchange Commission filings, but it was most likely in excess of $10 million. And it also was not a merger, it was a disposition.
So FERC did approve the acquisition.
Yes, sir.
And so Brayton Point is the plant that was closed. Is that the one you refer to in your testimony?
Yes, sir. That was a 1,500 megawatt coal-fired power plant.
Now, was it closed? I mean, you, Mr. Slocum, you said market manipulation. And if it's coal, I would think environmental had something to do with it as well.
Well, the low price of natural gas has put pressure on coal-fired electricity.
Right.
So it was closed for economic reasons, yeah, is what they claimed.
But the EPA regulation on existing coal plants also makes a big difference.
Right.
But whatever the reason, they closed that down, and that created a shortage of supply. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Correct.
And so that contributed to these higher rates.
It did.
Now, on the capacity markets, I'm certainly not an expert on capacity markets, and I know it's pretty complicated, but it's my understanding there are 2 areas of the country that have mandatory capacity markets. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And one of them is ISO New England, and one is it PJM?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, why do they feel like they're necessary, say, in New England, these mandatory capacity markets, but they're not necessary in other parts of the country?
In other parts of the country where there are no regional transmission authorities, RTOs, which ISO New England is one of them, they still use a cost of service model to finance power plants. A utility will still be vertically integrated and will still own their own capacity, their own power plants. So they will develop and construct a power plant and go to the state regulators, and the state regulators will review the cost structure, and as long as it's just and reasonable, they will pay the utility the full cost to construct and maintain that power plant.
And did I understand that the ISO New York has not allowed you to self-supply anymore? Is that correct?
ISO New England, correct.
I mean ISO New England.
Yes, correct. We're grandfathered for our existing power plants, municipal utilities are, but if we want to build a new plant in the future now, we can't build it in just on the backs of our own ratepayers.
So when you were talking about reforming the capacity markets, were you primarily focusing on the ability to self-supply, or is there some other area of reform you were referring to?
Well, all the markets, the forward capacity market for all utilities, for all generation in New England, setting aside self-supply for the moment, what happens is if an old power plant is still in existence, like many still are, when an auction clears, like the 8th forward capacity auction, new generation gets paid that very high price. It was $15 a kilowatt month. But existing generation gets an average price. So in this case, existing generation went from being paid $3 a kilowatt month to $7 a kilowatt month. So putting that in dollar terms, we have an old power plant, so I'm familiar with the numbers. We currently get about $2.5 million a year in capacity payments. It's really value because we self-supply.
Right.
It's $2.5 million a year, and it costs us about $2.5 million a year to maintain that plant. So just to have it sit there is a break-even proposition. After FCA 8 went through, if we were an independent generator, at $2.5 million for our old power plant, jumps to $6 million a year. So it's a windfall for the old plants that are just hanging around. The next auction in 2019, when FCA 9 cleared, and this will happen, that old power plant that we have would go from $2.5 million to $6 million, now to $9.5 million a year we're going to get just for sitting there, just for hanging around. So that's why this $1 billion in 2016 is jumping to $4 billion in 2018.
Well, I wish we could talk more about this. My time has expired. So, Mr. Rush, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Slocum, the bill amending Section 203, and that would exempt mergers or consolidation of facilities with a value of less than $10 million from FERC's Merger Review Authority has been portrayed as a very innocuous bill that would simply correct a drafting error from EPAC 2005 language. However, in your testimony, you take a decidedly different view on this legislation, and you state that even with mergers or consolidations under $10 million, it is possible that, and I quote you, a single facility or contract has the ability to be a pivotal supplier in a given market, providing the owner with an ability to unilaterally charge unjust and unreasonable rates. In the quote, can you give an example of how allowing this exemption from FERC review of mergers under $10 million might result in unjust and unreasonable rates?
Yes, sir. So let's take this Brayton Point facility that's been the subject of parts of this hearing. As the chairman pointed out, that was not a merger, and it also was in excess of $10 million. But let's assume theoretically that the Brayton Point facility was a standalone company that Energy Capital Partners was going to merge with in order to combine the two companies into one. It is likely that because of the age of the Brayton Point facility, that that transaction could have been valued at less than $10 million. And therefore, FERC, under this proposed legislation, would not be able to review that transaction. And that would be a problem, because as we identified in our market manipulation complaint, that single facility was what economists term a pivotal supplier in that market. And therefore, not allowing FERC the discretion to look at that kind of transaction, I think, is problematic. It's important to note that it isn't like FERC is a difficult place to submit a merger application. I cannot find, in the last 20 years, a single merger consolidation proposal that FERC has rejected outright. So this is not necessarily a difficult process. I understand that the $10 million threshold sounds like it's a reasonable proposal, but there are a number of examples where instituting this threshold would deny FERC the opportunity to review pivotal supplier transactions.
Well, Mr. Misner, from the first panel, indicated that FERC has other tools at its disposal to protect consumers, even in situations where a series of mergers take place, but not individually meet the $10 million standard. What do you think about that statement?
Well, I think that, you know, in the case of the transaction, the Energy Capital Partners acquisition of a portfolio of power plants, FERC approved that transaction, and yet the result of that transaction was that one entity was able to utilize the capacity of one power plant to have a $1 billion swing in energy prices. And so in this case, FERC reviewed the transaction, approved it, and then did not have safeguards in place. And even after we brought our market manipulation complaint, FERC still did not rule on it because they deadlocked 2-2. So at its core, the Federal Power Act is all about reviewing transactions. And we think it's very important that FERC retain the ability to be able to review any and all mergers and consolidations of facilities under its jurisdiction.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Marzan, you look like, did you want to say something?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't think anything that Mr. Slocum is saying frustrates the intent of Section 203. As he stated, that FERC still has the, he's bringing a complaint for market manipulation right now, and FERC still has, as the General Counsel stated, market power authority over all rates, and folks like Mr. Slocum and other citizens who want to bring a contest to market, suggesting market power, can do so, and FERC has full authority to review that. So I don't think any change to Section 203 frustrates FERC's ability to monitor these things.
Gentlemen's time's expired. At this time, Mr. Flores, you are recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Powell, a couple of quick questions for you.
Sir.
Would allowing an agency to utilize aerial data and to condition a permit on a follow-up ground survey interfere in any way with the integrity of the environmental review?
No, sir, I don't believe that it would. It's a very common practice even today. You know, landowners routinely deny survey permission. That is very common in every proceeding. And FERC uses its conditional authority to require us to go back and close any gaps that those other agencies administering those federal reviews require.
Well, let's go ahead and build on that. You know, in Mr. Lloyd's testimony, it appears that the testimony appears to be driven by his dissatisfaction with the FERC public interest review rather than any substantive criticism of H.R. 3021, outside of the notion that for some reason that FERC wouldn't require air survey data to be verified by a ground survey. So two parts to this. In your experience with these permitting decisions, do you have any reason to believe that an agency would ignore the authority provided in H.R. 3021, which states very, very clearly, and I quote, an agency accepting aerial survey data may require as a condition of approval that such aerial survey data be verified through the use of ground survey data before the construction or extension of a facility that is subject of such application, unquote. So do you have any reason to believe that FERC or any other agency would ignore that authority that's under HR, that's provided in HR 3021?
I would say as a general rule, no. I think there might be some specific places where I would say particularly a state agency that's administering 401 might, because they may want 100% before they would deem the application complete, which is why this legislation is that important.
Okay, good. Do you think that Mr. Lloyd's concerns are well-founded, given that, you know, it's verified by ground survey?
Not in my experience, sir.
Okay.
You know, as a matter of practice, prior to pre-filing, you know, applicants approach the regulatory agencies, the Fish and Wildlife Service, or the state agency administering their listed species program, the SHPO, I'm sorry, State Historic Preservation Office, and discuss which species should be considered in a particular project, what the survey protocol should be for those resources. And as you might imagine, most species don't occur across all geographies. And so it tends to be a very small subset of the overall list, and they tend to be unique to specific habitats, which you can't identify by and large. You may not be able to determine specifically whether the individual is there today, but you can very much limit the area that requires resurvey as a general rule. There are other species that are more broadly distributed, and okay, you would need to do that.
Okay, I've got a little bit of time left. Do you have any general comments on anything that's been said about FERC's environmental review process today?
Well, I think FERC's environmental review process is very good.
Okay.
They strongly encourage applicants to work with the landowners, and we do that. We do that throughout the process. We do that all the way to the very end of a process. And we want to obtain survey permission, and we want to do the required surveys to complete the record. There's really no benefit to us to having an incomplete record, you know, that late in the project. So we do very diligently try to get that, but what is needed is a solution so that we know that those landowners, there are going to generally be some landowners that are going to say no. And we need a mechanism where a regulatory agency can't say, well, this one individual said no, therefore, you know, I don't have to review your permit. And I can wait till after the certificate and after the order and after eminent domain until you can gain access. And okay, now my regulatory review clock starts. And that happens.
Okay. Thanks, Mr. Powell. I thank the rest of the witnesses for their testimony. Mr. Chairman, I yield back the balance of my time.
Chairman yields back. Mr. McNerney is recognized for 5 minutes.
Well, thank the chairman, and I thank the witnesses this morning. Mr. Slocum, what would be the practical effects of the merger legislation?
The practical effects would be that any merger consolidation under $10 million would not be subject to FERC review.
So you think there would be a rush of unquestioned mergers at that point?
I don't know if there would be a rush, but I think that there, theoretically and practically, you could have a merger or consolidation structured in a way to ensure that you get under that threshold amount.
Okay.
And particularly with, as we see a lot of older generation, whether they're older nuclear power plants or older coal-fired units, that for a variety of reasons by themselves are not worth very much, but as part of a larger portfolio could be extremely valuable. And we just think that it's not prudent policy to not allow FERC to review those transactions when they're first proposed.
Thank you. Mr. Leahy, in your testimony, you mentioned that the S 2012 contains provisions to extend construction timelines to 8 years. What are some of the biggest obstacles that prevent construction post-licensing?
Sir, thank you. As I mentioned in my testimony, particularly on these pieces of infrastructure, these existing dams that are owned by the federal facilities, once FERC issues the license for the project, there still may be supplemental permits that are required to get either from the Bureau of Reclamation or from the Army Corps of Engineers. And delays in that permitting process can then cause those delays that require the applicants or the licensees to come back to Congress individually. The cases before you also have a variety of other issues that come up post-licensing. Sometimes, in one of the cases, I believe it was getting easements for purposes of the transmission line. In others, there were unexpected issues that resulted when work started at the dam. So a variety of things can pop up post-licensing that could cause those delays.
Unfortunately, I think the answer is no. I mean, the data that we've looked at shows that, you know, often endangered species are underground. Often, if you have to delineate a wetland, you have to do digging in the ground to find out the kind of soils that are there. I wish, you know, I could tell you that aerial surveying would solve the problem, but for a large number of species that we've looked at, it will not solve the problem. And if I may, our experience has been that that FERC is not getting enough environmental data to adequately do its job. And what we're finding is when a state permitting agency has to come in and do permits, they have to look at those permits in a much more granular way, generate a lot more environmental data, and enables them to make a better decision. We think that that information ought to be in front of FERC when FERC makes its decision in the first place, and that would help the process, not harm it. I don't think we've experienced it yet. We've had concerns about helicopters and low-flying aircraft. I be honest with you, given where the technology is going in this country, I think drones may be the next step. And you know, we may all need to look at that and to see whether that is not you know, an invasion of the use of private property by using drones to go over private property.
I mean,
well, it is the kind of thing we're talking about. I mean, we've landowners in New Jersey have already experienced adverse impacts from helicopters, and as I said, I expect that drones might be even more invasive, and you know, I don't think we've addressed that issue at all as yet.
Well, I think that concludes our questions, except for our friend Mr. Kennedy, so we'll recognize him for 5 minutes as well.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the time. I appreciate the witnesses being here, your testimony, and you guys sticking around for me to ask a couple questions as well. Mr. Battigi, I heard ISO say that their market rules are vital to ensuring reliability. I was wondering if you could share your take on that. And this capacity markets, are capacity markets the only way to make sure that new generation gets built?
Electric utilities have been around since the 1800s, including Braintree Electric, and we think we've provided very reliable service in that 120 years. Capacity markets have been around since 2007. So there was a way to do it before the capacity markets. I do not think they're vital. I think generators have to be paid enough revenue to cover their costs, but paying this windfall to old generation, I don't believe is necessary.
So I've seen recent analyses that show that over 90% of new generating capacity has been constructed under bilateral contracts or utility ownership, but not solely for sale into capacity markets run by RTOs. What do you think this finding says about the ability of capacity markets to achieve the needed generation mix to meet the reliability and policy goals?
The forward capacity market, as we experience it, in my opinion, drives short-term decision-making A long-term decision for a utility is 40 years, whether it's electrical infrastructure or generation assets. So the RTOs drive utilities to make short-term, or the owners of generation to make a fairly short-term decision. 7 years now is what you get paid for capacity if you clear the auction as a new resource. That's a short-term decision. Those same decisions, that same short-term window is only 1 year. Each year is a new market for existing generation. So the nuclear power plants that are closing in New England, Vermont Yankee, Pilgrim Nuclear Power Plant, and then in New York, Fitzpatrick, are all basing that decision on a short-term window. When you get out of the RTO markets, you get down south, and they're still building generation under the old cost of service model, that long-term view of the world that you need for these major expenses. That's why those assets are being built down there, and they aren't being built in New England.
You mentioned that Braintree has been able to self-supply its capacity, but that option was taken away for further generation. What does that mean for your ratepayers going forward, and how does the current rate-making process for Braintree work within the structure of capacity markets? Finally, with regards to that, in your opinion, how critical is a review by the federal regulator to ensure that rates are, in fact, just and reasonable?
Well, Braintree Electric, being a municipal utility, for the most part, is not regulated. We set our own rates. I report to a three-member light board. That the rates that we control within town, like our distribution system, we're not regulated. The capacity markets are regulated at the state and regional level in New England by ISO New England. When deregulation occurred, since we were allowed to stay vertically integrated and own our own generation, the next step was when the capacity markets were started, the ISO New England agreed you can self-supply your own generation. You don't get paid for it as a generator, and your load doesn't pay for it. You're revenue neutral. Mm-hmm. So off we went, and I built the 115-megawatt new state-of-the-art gas turbines that way. The ISO was led to believe that we had market power. The little municipal utilities had market power over New England. We only have a few hundred megawatts of generation, and there's 33,000 megawatts of generation, but they were convinced that that gave us market power to manipulate the system, so they took that self-supply option away from us. So flash forward to today, we have an old combined cycle power plant, about 40 years old now, that we would like to replace with new modern generation. If we could self-supply, I could go to the town, borrow money, general obligation bonds at a very low rate, build a new power plant. Our ratepayers would pay off the debt service, and we would provide that capacity for our own needs. Since we can't self-supply, we need to bid against other private companies into the forward capacity market in order to try and replace that old generation. It's much harder to do. We've been at it for 3 years. We'd be well underway replacing that generation now if we knew we could, with certainty, get credit for that capacity.
Thank you, Chairman. I yield back.
I think we need to spend more time on these capacity markets.
Yeah. I can come back.
Thank you.
Mr. Rush, you have additional questions?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do have an additional question for Mr. Lloyd. Mr. Lloyd, recent studies have suggested that many of the states in the Northeast region do not require new natural gas infrastructure to meet their energy needs. According to FERC's 2014 State of the Market report, the Northeast is a net exporter of natural gas as of the summer of 2014. The Attorney General of Massachusetts commissioned a study that determined the New England states do not need new infrastructure to meet their energy needs. And given the Northeast region is a net exporter of natural gas. Is there a risk of overbuilding natural gas infrastructure in the Northeast? And how does FERC's policy of certification of new interstate natural gas pipeline facilities address the possibility of overbuilding?
Thank you, Congressman. I think there is a risk of overcapacity, and this goes directly to the FERC process. FERC looks at, it's, as I said, it's got 80 pipelines pending in front of it right now. Many of them are in the Northeast. They are looking at those pipelines on an individual basis, and they are assessing the need for those pipelines by looking at whether those pipelines have a contract for gas. Now, we have some examples where the companies contracting for gas are related corporate entities to the companies that are building the pipelines. So there's self-dealing going on there, and it doesn't appear that FERC is going beyond just looking at the contract. So what we're seeing, I don't think FERC is adequately examining all of the infrastructure at once. They're looking at pipeline by pipeline, and then we don't have an opportunity to look at what is the infrastructure that we actually need in the Northeast. Do we need 12 pipelines, for instance, crossing the Delaware River, or could we meet our needs with far fewer pipelines? And as you pointed out, because the Northeast and New Jersey in particular are net exporters of gas now, it's a real question about whether there is a need for gas. And if we build this new infrastructure, the danger is we're going to be taking gas from existing infrastructure and we're going to end up with wasted assets. And we've experienced this, if I may, we experienced this in New Jersey with the nuclear industry, where in fact we began to look at three nuclear power plants. We spent $1 billion in looking at those plants and never built any of them. Now, the good news is, because we didn't build them, there was no environmental impact. The bad news is, because we didn't have a mechanism in place, a regulatory mechanism in place, to review those expenses before the utilities made them, the ratepayers ended up paying them. I fear that we may face the same situation with natural gas infrastructure, where we're building pipelines that ultimately we may not need. And then we will have to pay for those investments in one way or the other.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Let me just ask a question. We've had a lot of hearings on the supply of gas in the Northeast. I was not aware that the Northeast is considered a net exporter of natural gas. Is that the case, or is that not the case?
As Congressman said, the Attorney General of Massachusetts did just such an analysis and said that they were a net exporter, and this was, in regards to pipelines that were proposed to serve Massachusetts. We've seen had the same experience in New Jersey, where in fact we have no net need for gas right now. One of the bases that the companies are justifying the pipeline is redundancy. But this is a question I think that FERC needs to address: should we have redundant supply in New Jersey, in the Northeast, or anywhere? And I don't think FERC's has mechanisms in place to examine that. One way we've suggested that they might get at that is through a programmatic environmental impact statement, which would look at a number of pipelines, not just one pipeline, and see what, in fact, the overall need is. And perhaps we lead to a decision that assures that we have adequate supply for the Northeast and for New Jersey, but also assure that we're not overbuilding to leave ratepayers with a bill that they may not want to pay.
Did you have a comment on that, Mr. Powell?
No, sir. I'm no expert on market.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I might respectfully request that you ask the Attorney General of Massachusetts.
I'm going to go up there and see him.
Well, take me with you.
I will. I've been wanting to go up there to Baintree anyway. I do want to ask one additional last question for Mr. Marzahn, because in his written testimony he said that since enactment of the Energy Policy Act of 2005 that FERC has been interpreting, I think, Section 203 to mean that any acquisition of any utility property that they would have to give pre-approval. And I was just curious if you might just give us a couple of examples of that you consider particularly maybe egregious or...
I can speak from my own experience on this. I'll just give you three of our own company's transactions that we've had to seek 203 approval for. A 12-kilovolt line and land rights for $1,513, a relay for $2,802, and miscellaneous substation equipment, $2,874.
Sorry, so, would you just turn your microphone on and so that our transcriber can hear?
Okay. Can you hear me better now? Okay, I'll just go through this again. $1,513 for a 12-kilovolt line and land rights, $2,802 for relays, and $2,874 for miscellaneous substation equipment. So in each of those cases, we had to take the expense of drafting a 203 application, the legal fees as such associated with it, file it with FERC. FERC had to do their due diligence, as the general counsel of FERC stated before, on transactions that would have no impact whatsoever on the grid.
Well, thank you very much for that, and thank you all for your testimony, and we look forward to additional contact with you as we try to decide what we're doing with this legislation. I also would ask unanimous consent that we enter into the record a letter of support from Advanced Hydro Solutions, statement for the record from Clark Canyon Hydro, a statement from Congressman Zinke in support of H.R. 2080 and 2081, and a statement of record from the American Rivers, and I think you all have seen this.
No objection, Mr.
No objection. And so that will conclude today's hearing, and the record will remain open for 10 days, and we look forward to working with you all. Thank you very much for your time and your testimony. That concludes today's hearing.
Thank you.